Okay, so today we're talking about Chapter 3, Section 2, properties of a function's graph. Okay, so if you thought we were done with graphs, I got bad news for you. We're going to be talking about graphs until our ears bleed. All right. Section, we take a close look at a function's graph by discussing some of its characteristics. A good place to start is to talk about a function's intercepts. An intercept of a function is a point on the graph of a function where the graph either crosses or touches a coordinate axis. Intercepts can be represented by ordered pairs of the form a, comma 0 or 0, b, right, 0, comma b. Okay, so let's go ahead and the value of a changes. Okay, so that zero is the x. Okay, so that means that we're neither going left or right on the x-axis, but the b is what's changing. So we're not going left or right on the x-axis, we're just going up and down that y-axis. So there are two types of intercepts, and we see that. One, the y-intercept is the y-coordinate of the point where the graph crosses or touches the y-axis. If a function has an intercept at a point 0, b, then the y-intercept is b, and that's what we see here. And then the x-intercept are the x-coordinates of the point where the graph crosses or touches the x-axis. If a function has an intercept at a point a, comma 0, then the x-intercept is at a, and that's what we see here. Okay. Also, I want to take the time to say that my pre-calculus course, chapter one or chapter two. We went over it really quick because snip this example because I'm in the statement, but again, the function, all right, this is the same function right here, the f of x equal to negative 3x plus 2. That's what I'm just rewriting here. Can't see that because it's white. Good job. F of x is equal to negative 3x plus 2. Okay. Again, what we're going to do is we're going to set up this equation right here. We're going to set it equal to 0. Okay. So we're going to say negative 3x plus 2 is equal to 0. And actually, let's go ahead and let's write this out like we did the previous one. So we'll do this. So we're going to say to find the x Using technology? We don't use technology around here, do we? No. Alright. I mean, we do, but I don't want you get using. I don't want you to graph it, right? So let's see. We've got a new page. Alright, so this reads, in section 3.1, we see that every function has a graph. Figure 6 illustrates how we could use a function's graph to determine the domain and the range. The domain is the set of all input values, x values, and the range is the set of all output values, the y values. Okay, so let's make this a little bigger. Oh, that's not it. Make it a little bit. Try it again. There we go. Okay, so we're gonna make this a tad bigger. Okay, so let's start here. The domain is a set of all input values, x. Okay, so the domain is going to be everything that you see that exists on the x-axis. Okay, so again, real quick, this here, the cross, right? This thing here, we call that the plane. Okay, the image that we draw on the plane, this is the graph. Okay, so wherever that graph exists on the plane, okay, and we see in this particular case it exists from, you know, A to B, then that's the domain. Okay, the x. Now the y is where does this graph exist on the plane, and it exists, you know, from down here and it goes all the way up to here, or from C to D. Okay, so that's how we write the domain and range, or that's how we determine, rather, the domain and range of a graph graphically. Okay. It is important to note also the open and closed circles. Okay, so in A, we're going to write the domain, and we're going to do the range like this. Okay, so the domain and the range. Okay, so the domain. Okay, so where does this graph exist on the x-axis? So what we're going to do is we're going to look here at the x-axis. Okay, and we're going to say, okay, so it goes from here to here. Okay, but of course, you know, the x's are essentially already given to you, or you can see the x, it's not really necessarily given to you, but it looks like from negative 2 all the way to positive 4. Okay, so let's go ahead and write that real quick, but we're not gonna deal with parentheses or brackets just yet. Okay, so let's erase that now. Okay, so now looking at this, here at negative 2 on the domain, notice how we don't include it because it is an open circle. Okay, since it's an open circle, this tells me that I'm not including negative 2. I'm getting infinitesimally close to, or infinitely, close to negative 2. I'm going to negative 1.999999999, right? But I'm not getting that to negative 2. However, here at positive 4, we see we do actually get there, right? It's a closed circle, so we include it. Okay, so that's the domain. Now the range, okay, so the range, again, we're looking on here on the y-axis. Okay, so it exists down here, it looks like, right there at 0, and it's going all the way up to about right here. Okay, and again, we are told at least one of them, and we have to make a pretty reasonable assumption about the first one, right? So it exists, it looks like, from 0 all the way up to 6. Okay, and looking at this, it looks like we do include the number 0, so we're going to put a bracket there. And it looks like we are also including the number 6 because it's a closed circle there. So we do include that. So we're going to go from 0 to 6. domain. It looks like it's going from